get your first and last name and the spelling of it, please?
Yes, I am Andrew Dixon, spelling AndrewDixon.
Okay, and can I have where you lived in the Seventh Ward?
Oh, so I grew up on Green Street. I grew up on Green and Locust and Church Street. Like, that's where I grew up around.
So tell me how was it growing up in those neighborhoods back in the day?
It was wild. It was a good time. It was a good time. We ran around. We were parkouring before parkouring was a thing. It was just called getting away from cops or playing tag or just roof hopping. It was a good time, but we found things to do. Whether we were going down to the pool to swim or just swimming down the river, we were everywhere.
So let's talk about your family members. Did you come from a big family? Did you come from a small intimate family? Did you come from a large intimate family? Mm-hmm. Let's talk about your family.
I come from a very big family. I'm a Dixon, so in this area, in Lancaster, the Dixons are one of the bigger families, you know. And then we're connected to the Robinsons, the Browns, the Wilsons, you know, where it spans off. You know, so there are a lot of cousins, a lot of family members around. So it's always been that big family time feel. My grandfather came from South Carolina, from St. Helens, South Carolina. You know, so he was on an island, so he was always around water. When he came up, he made sure he got us out and got us around. Even if it was in town, he kept us in nature.
All right. So first question. What can you tell us about your experience with the river, specifically talking about down on South Prince Street?
Oh, man. Well, my experience with the river on South Prince Street. When we were younger, you know, we used to jump off the bridge down there, you know, down in the quarry. We used to jump off the bridge down into the water. A couple people got pulled over before, got pulled under. You know, there were some drownings, but that didn't deter us. That didn't deter us from continuing to swim down in that river. You know, whether we were doing that or we were fishing out of it, there were different things going on. I remember some of the days, some of the runoffs, the creek, the runoffs, we would build dams, you know, catch minnow, what are water skippers. You know, these were my experiences outdoors. So that it helped me get out of that, the city boy, you know, that city boy feel. Just it helped me come more in tune with nature.
All right, and becoming more in tune with nature, how has that helped shape who you are today? Have you passed that same love and passion down to your kids?
Yes, I feel I have. You know, I grew up, after playing in the river, you know, I got the chance to go out into the mountains to hunt, you know, to experience a different side of life. And from that, I ended up joining the military. And joining the military, I learned survival tactics. You know, I learned how to survive outdoors and how to actually, like, live off the land. You know, so it's a good experience. I gave it to my kids because I want that to constantly become one with nature so they can appreciate it and everything that it has to offer.
So, what did you all choose to do more of, go down to the county pool or swim in the river?
Well, if we didn't have money, we were definitely in the river. You know, whether that was the river right outside of the pool, you know, we were in there, and in there with some water shoes, hoping we didn't step on glass, cut our toes, you know, or, you know, we just found somewhere to go. You know, we found some spot, some part of the river to hot jump into, you know, whether it was under the bridge going on the back way towards Rocky Springs Bowling Alley. You know, there was a bridge back there we used to go down. So there's plenty of spots.
All right. Can you tell us about some positive experiences that you had a young kid?
I would say breaking my fear of heights, you know, but not breaking my fear of heights, but like having being a thrill seeker, it kind of made me become a thrill seeker, you know, made me realize that things ain't so scary. You know, my first time jumping off the bridge, you know, I was young, you know, I might have been in, I don't know, maybe third grade. Like, I don't know. Not third. I hope not. Maybe sixth or seventh grade. All right, I'll say a little sixth or seventh grade. You know, when I was old, the thing was, like, I was old enough to know better. You know, old enough to know better. And I seen everybody doing it ahead of me, you know, and I didn't let it scare me. I didn't let, you know, I mean, I felt something inside. But I'm like, if they can do it, I can do it. So that's always been my thing. If someone else can do it, that means, and then I know I can do it.
Summers in Lancaster, specifically summers that have to deal with around the river, mm-hmm. around swimming, mm-hmm. around Camp Hogan. Mm-hmm. Take us back to those memories.
So my grandfather, he used to drive bus. So he used to drive bus, take kids out to the camp. You know, whether it was Hogan and there was also another one, Camp, I think it was Camp Shan as well. You know, we were along the river and it was just the experience of being out there, like going to sleep listening to the water, you know, hearing the water. And that constant run is like something you can only get in an app if it's not something you experienced or if you've been down by the river or have ever slept by the river. You know, it's a different experience that they don't have anywhere else. You know, so being a kid, oh man, just everything from rafting on it. You know, I used to raft tubing down the river, like all the different fun things I used to do. It's like lasting memories that you don't think you're gonna remember, you know, but like being who I am today, like dealing with memory loss, you know, PTSD, all that stuff. Like those, I remember those memories vividly.
All right, so would you swim in the river today?
Yes, I would. I still would. I know the water's horrible for you. You know, but I grew up in it, you know, so I feel like I built up an immune system. I already have this toxicity about my body that, you know, that'll kind of repel it or just kind of blend in with it. So that's where I'm at with that.
All right. So would you let your kids swim in the river today?
Yeah, I would. I feel like sometimes you need to build stronger antibodies. So, you know, jump in the pond. Just as long as it's away from the, I wouldn't let them go down to some of the spots I used to, though. I wouldn't let them jump off the bridge down at the quarry, you know, so some of them things, you know, I would keep them away from. But I definitely want them to experience the river and have their own memories.
All right, your current thoughts or concerns about the state of the river, whether it be runoff, whether it be, you know, the legislation, mm-hmm. Current thoughts.
I speak in jest when I say I want my kids to swim for stronger antibodies, this and that, you know, but the problem, the river is bad for you. Like the runoff from all the years of toxic waste, from people dumping into it, you know, it's bad and it's not good for you. And it sucks because that's something it's nature, you know, it's something we should take care of and appreciate, you know, and find ways to make it better, you know, instead of only making it worse and just telling people to stay out of the water. You know, I think about the Simpson movie, you know, where they had the radioactive water from years of dumping stuff into it, you know. And I don't want us to get to that level, you know, but I feel like, hey, one of our generations is going to see it. You know, one of our kids is going to end up seeing it down the line, like, if we don't take care of the problem, no.
Right. So how do you feel as though that we can take care of the problem right now?
Oh, man, by listening to people who know. Well, listening to people who know about these things, you know, by keeping your trash out of the water, but not dumping, you know, by controlling the output of waste that's being put into our water, you know, put into our water stream.
All right, moving right along here, Mr. Dixon, you're doing all right.
Oh, thank you. First time I'm shy on camera.
Yeah, I can tell. It's all right. Just, you know, take a breather. Right here. So. Do you think that there's anything that our local administration can do with improving conditions of the river?
I think if there are things they can do, they need to jump on board with it. You know, the water companies have profited. They've made money over the years. You know, and why is a water company making profit money? Why are they making profits? Like, I never understood something like that. Like, a public service is into trying to make money for itself. Like, okay, I get in making money to fund yourself, to pay for yourself, or to fund whatever new things. But to say, oh, we're in profits, to be a private market for a public, in a public sector, you know, is, I feel it's wrong. You know, and we shouldn't be concerned about profit. We should be more with upgrading our water systems, you know. You can't, how are we still operating on a water system that was put in place how many years ago? You know, where are we at technology-wise? Where are we at construction-wise? You know, we haven't advanced or upgraded. You know, we can't continue to operate off medieval piping. You know, I want to be in a different century.
Let's talk about the county pool and your experience with the county pool. Have you had any racial experiences?
I haven't personally, you know, but you know, they're around. You know, people have experienced them. You know, I think about my aunt Shell. She's an older woman. You know, and I think about her experiences. You know, she talks about, you know, other different times for, you know, different color codes for swimming and everything. You know, and you know, I feel like there should be more than one pool in the city. You know, there's only one pool. You know, and we're not a small city anymore. You know, it doesn't fit everybody. You know, so then when one kid has an accident in the pool, then it stops the pool for how long? Then all these kids that walked from however far to get to this park, to get to the pool, are now have to go and swim in the river. And the river's not good for them. They're going home sick. You know, or some kids are going to get a disease, and some kids could pass. You know, so these are the different things that I feel happen and need, that we can control, we can mitigate. You know, whether that's by opening up another pool and, you know, maintaining our river just for that, to have a free open source so people can jump into the river and swim.
All right, so our last two questions, Mr. Dixon. So this is a two-parter. Any lasting, we'll start with negative thoughts. Any lasting negative thoughts about the river and any improvements you want to see done today?
Lasting negative thoughts. Like, if it was in your backyard, I don't know. I just want to say, like, if it was yours, would you do it to yours? You know, like, just because you don't see it every day, you know, just because, you know, you're not near it every day, you don't think about it or talk about it every day, doesn't mean it's not there. You know, like, we survive off this land. This land doesn't survive off of us. You know, so we need to control the dumping. Why are we continuing to allow things that we know are wrong? You know, we have the facts. We can no longer be old and, we can't be old and dumb and ignorant in our ways. Like, we have to be willing to move. We have to be willing to make the changes. You know, don't keep doing things the same and don't keep trying to patch it up. All right? The expression in the military we call is band-aids for bullet wounds. You know, don't try and fix a little problem. Find a bigger problem. Fix the whole big problem. And how was the last part of that question you said?
Things I
want to see done today. Oh man, a reduction in dumping, a reduction in the waste today. Like, I want to see that. Like how much are we allowing being poured in this? You know, or even do an analysis of all the pipes and the piping systems for everybody's water. You know, water's contaminated in different parts of the neighborhood every day. Like, there's like a water boil advisory. You know, why? Why is there a water boil advisory every other day? You know, why is it like that? It shouldn't be like that, right? Like, how many people really get that advisory? You know, people are drinking that water with or without the advisory. You know, many a times people without the advisory are drinking it and going about their day, showering, doing everything they can in this water that's contaminated. But hey, we put out an advisory, so don't do it. You know, we can't expect that. It takes more than that.
Final question, anything I missed, or is there anything that you would like to add?
I would encourage people to if you have any memories, to think about them, think about the memories down at the river, the fun times you had, whether it was catching crawfish, you know, or catching minnow, or water skippers, skipping rocks, tubing, all those good times that will never go away. They won't fade. You know, and think about it for the next generation, the generation after that. You know, do we want this river to still be there? Or do we want it to be one of the growing cess green, like growing green lime radiation river that we see out of a episode of The Simpsons? You know, it starts with us, right? It starts with everybody individually doing their part, but going all out and going for these water companies, making sure they're doing what they need to do.
All right. Well, Mr. Dixon, we want to thank you for that testimonial.
All right. Yes.
And yeah.